36. Dan Ige is 30. Ige, the taller man, but barely. Both fighters successfully making weight. Dan Ige will enjoy a one-inch reach advantage. All right, now for the introductions, back inside to Bruce.
Ladies and gentlemen, this fight is three rounds in the UFC featherweight division. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, a mixed martial artist holding a professional record, 15 wins, 4 losses. He stands 5 feet 7 inches tall, weighing in at 146 pounds. Fighting out of Las Vegas, Nevada, from Haleiwa, Hawaii, presenting the number 9 ranked featherweight contender in the world, Dan 50K Ige. And now introducing his opponent, fighting out of the red corner, a freestyle fighter holding a professional record, 16 wins, 2 losses. He stands 5 feet 6 and 1 half inches tall, weighing in at 145 and 1 half pounds. Fighting out of Sacramento, California, presenting the number 7 ranked featherweight contender in the world, Josh Emmett. And when the action begins, our referee in charge, Chris Coyote.
Well, Josh Emmett was an NAIA wrestler at Menlo College, but he says, I'm here because of the highlight reel knockouts, and there have certainly been a lot of them. Great to see Josh Emmett back on the proven ground tonight. Ladies, Dan Ige, plus 125, the underdog tonight. Josh Emmett favored at minus 145 as he tries to make up for lost time and get the inside lane on a possible title fight at some point in 2022. This fight clock is brought to you by Toyo Tires, the official tire of UFC. Emmett in black. Dan 50K Ige is in what?
You spoke about Josh Emmett's wrestling background. If you watched his fights, you would think he doesn't possess wrestling because he loves to just be in these knockdown, drag out wars. And Dan Ige is more than willing to give you exactly that.
One of the things, though, that a lot of really powerful wrestlers do possess, though, is when the ability to move across the octagon so quickly to shoot a double is the same kind of power that allows him to throw that right hand, because he can close that distance so quickly. And that's what he does, it almost like a wrestler. I mean, when he shoots in for that right hand, it's like shooting in for a power double. And he throws everything into it.
I mean, obviously, the guy's strong, right? Look at him.
Well, he began his UFC career in
20. There it is. There it is. That's the right hand you were talking about, Joe. Right there.
Ige eating some body shots here. Minute gone by.
I mean, one of the most devastating punchers in this division. And Ige just felt it. And he's in real trouble now. He just hit him with a nice elbow, too. Oh, but Ige caught the knee. Ige's got him down. Look at this.
Beautiful response by Ige.
Good butterfly on the left side by... Look at that. Emmett uses that butterfly to get back up, and Ige slams him right back down again.
Ige's
taking his back.
Ige just kept that leg. Now Ige's almost there, but Josh is out. He
Josh
got too
is
high.
So strong. And Josh reverses the position. Look at this. Emmett is such a gorilla.
Emmett began his UFC career as a lightweight in 2016. 5-1 since dropping down to 145.
Oh, another hard right hand. My goodness, the sound those punches make. Ige's still a little more.
Yeah, he still hurt a little bit. You saw him take a bad step as he walked back to the center.
And man, Emmett looks like a lightweight. Under 3 minutes here, round one.
And he's a big fella. And as he moves back, you can see it's just all looking for that fastball.
Nice connection with the
left
hand.
It is a fastball, Joe.
It is, right?
I told John what my fastest fastball was last week. He didn't believe me.
Last week, he's telling a national television audience he could throw a baseball 95 miles per hour.
You won't believe him?
Stipe, where you at,
that's
man?
That's my boy, Joe, right there.
I said he's under 69 and a half. Emmett's knee did not initially respond well to the surgery. His kneecap and his patella didn't heal. Had to undergo some extensive procedures and rehab and physical therapy, and back tonight.
To watch Ige recover as quickly as he did from that massive right hand is very impressive.
I mean, you want to talk about having confidence in your power. Josh Emmett's, like, that's 85% of his game plan.
Yeah, he's strong. And I mean, when you hurt just about everybody that you touch with the right hand, you get this confidence about yourself. And rightfully so. And yeah. Josh Emmett has that.
And he carries it late into the fight. The Michael Johnson knockout is a great example of that. I mean, that was just a crazy knockout. A fight where he was down, and he throws that fastball right down the middle, and Johnson goes to sleep.
And it's amazing to hear guys like Andre Feely and Danny Castillo talk about Josh Emmett, how hard he works. Danny's sore this week, man. You work with Josh Emmett all week, right? Holding mitts, holding pads. These guys are paying for it.
But Dan Ige has responded well to this point. He's got his bearings back and bottom, and he's landed a beautiful jab many, many times.
Well, Ige is as tough as they come, and he's been through those hard wars. The Calvin Cater fight, the Edson Barboza fight. You get a victory over Edson Barboza in a fight that is, a lot of it is striking.
And short notice.
Yeah.
Emmett now tied with Jeremy Stephens for most knockdowns in UFC featherweight history with 11. And that's in just 10 UFC fights, by the way, for Emmett.
Wow. Dude's almost getting a knockdown a fight.
Right, compared to 30-plus fights for Stephens.
Crazy.
Love you, Jer. Ige just missed on the left hook. He's moving well laterally tonight.
Oh!
Big shot from Emmett.
Just the sound, the difference when they land.
Leg kick late in the round for Ige. We're right back.
Good job, boys. Good job.
Definite kinship between Dan Ige and his corner men, Eric Nixick and Jimmy Gifford. And Joe, the message was they want him to get back to the jab. Eats a big right hand early.
Yeah, he ate that one quick. He tried to say in the corner that he didn't get hurt, but clearly he got hurt.
He got hurt. He went down. I mean, anytime a tough guy like Dan Ige gets hit and starts backing up then just falls, he got hurt.
No doubt. They want him to use that jab and use his speed. I think the consequences of a guy like Emmett are so great. Like right there, just barely missed with that right hand.
But you see, Ige has more technical skills in terms of striking.
Ooh.
He went to the body there, the jab. Look at that. Just kind of going backwards, step forward, hit him with the jab.
Yeah, I don't think it's that Emmett doesn't have those skills.
He just believes in the hand.
Yeah, he has that power, and it's so great.
But does that become like a detriment, right? Okay. When you believe in one thing so much that you're not willing to do all the things and use all the tools that you have at your disposal.
Well, that was a good example right there. We slipped a punch.
Yes.
And came up over and countered. He's settling in now.
And Ige known to play with a lot of open and stance switches. They called for the southpaw stance after round one. He goes to it now. Shot from Ige.
The size difference is very apparent.
Yeah.
I'd like to get Josh Emmett on a scale right now.
I wonder what he weighs on fight day. I bet he's over 165.
It looks like it. And look at Ige, composed, looking for his shots.
Yeah, he'll take his time. He won't rush. That left hook was nasty.
Especially.
Caught him in the right hand.
Yep.
Watch out for the punch on the break.
Stop grabbing the shorts, Josh. He's going to break dirty. Be ready. Be ready.
So Ige critical of himself for forcing the knockout against the Korean Zombie last time out, not at all forcing it tonight. After a big land here midway through round two.
That was a nice jab there by Ige too. Stuck him. And you see Josh Emmett breathing out of the open mouth now.
And that's the detriment to throwing everything so hard. It's like regardless of what type of shape you're in, you'll start to fatigue.
Yes. Ooh, Ige.
Beautiful.
That's a very sharp jab. And that was what Eric was calling for in the corner.
And the one thing about Josh Emmett, he's very big, but he's short. He's not the tallest guy. I mean, even Dan's a little taller than him, but he's got to get a little more active if he wants to get to Dan Ige right now. It won't be one shot. He's got to mix it up.
Ooh. Oh. Josh retreating now. He looks vulnerable in these exchanges.
Well, that big right hand there from Ige just says, give me some respect. I'm here. I can punch. You know, I've got power.
Right.
Yeah, and Ige just popped him again with that jab. That jab is an excellent weapon for Ige.
90 seconds to go in the round. Ige keeping that guard high.
The way Ige moves his head, feints the jab, and then he puts the jab on Emmett right now is allowing him to be out ahead of Emmett right now. And that's the experiences of being in front of Calvin Kattar for 5 rounds. Being in front of the Korean Zombie for 5 rounds. I mean, he spent 50 minutes in front of two of the best featherweights in the world.
It's a great point. You're talking about almost an hour in the octagon since Josh Emmett was last here. Final minute of round two.
We may have 1-1 going into the third. It's going to be on Josh Emmett to really mix it up. He's got to throw multiple strikes at Dan Ige. He's got the ability, like you said, Joe. He just slipped there, but instead of throwing, started to load up that right hand again.
Oh. He's just so accustomed to hitting people and watching them fall. And he knows he has that power. But as you said, that can be a detriment because you put all your eggs in that basket.
Yep.
See, he just dips his weight, spreads his legs, and winds up. And Ige is sensing it coming, and he's out of the range. Beautiful jab.
Oh, nice counter right from Ige, who responded well in round two. Round three is brought to you by P3, the official protein snack of UFC. And there was the big left hand from Ige in round two.
Last round, boys, here we go. Fight.
A very hyped up Eric Nixick in the corner of Dan Ige.
Well, it went according to plan. It went what they got what they wanted out of their fighter. And in the Emmett corner, you heard them say, stop trying to knock him out. We feel like you're the better boxer. Just let your hands go and throw a combination.
Emmett to the body, now up top. Ige a near 3-1 favorite on the live number. Ige's jab lands again. He's outlanded Emmett 47-32.
Nice jab.
Pretty.
Just over 4 minutes to go. Dean Thomas, what do you have, sir?
They made a lot of good adjustments in dealing with the right hand of Emmett, but a couple of things that he could do now to really secure it is use his left leg a little more. He could, because Emmett's stance is so wide, that left leg could keep him off balance. And he can also come high with the left leg. That'll keep Emmett's right hand right in place to keep him from throwing it.
See if he heard you. Quick hands from Ige there.
Well, Ige's just moving the whole time.
Ooh!
Can't do that. Nice lands there by Emmett. And you still see it, right? We're in the third round, and when Emmett lands, it stops Ige for a second. It always makes him pause. But he cannot get hit by him. Yes.
Yeah. He's so much behind it. I mean, but look at his doing. Hands low, just everything into every punch.
But this is better, right? Like, he's fighting a better round already, because not only did he land those two big shots, but he's throwing more, and he's kind of matching the activity of Dan Ige.
For Dan Ige, I think the key is that, right there, that jab. His jab is just so pretty.
20th
timing.
20th pro fight for Ige. He has still never been finished as a pro. Again, switching up the stance here.
We started to see the jab become such an important weapon in mixed martial arts, especially Rob Font, who has a tremendous jab, and now Dan Ige displaying a super high-level jab.
Seemingly anybody's fight. Half a round to go.
Yeah, it really is, right? Any big moment.
And you hear Eric Nixick calling for Ige to be smart in the pocket here. Emmett moving a lot better here, round three.
Yes, he is, John, and he's throwing, he's landing. He's not on the end of the jab, just kind of watching. He's having a much better third round.
Dana switched to southpaw, and he switches back and forth so easily.
But the activity of Dan Ige is kind of falling off a little bit. He's not as active because Josh Emmett is moving. He can't line him up for that jab as he did in round number two.
Those are your numbers just in round three.
Good shot.
Good head movement there by Emmett. Ige with a body attack. 1 minute now to go.
Oh, beautiful job by Ige, just faking the takedown. Thirty seconds in a very close round.
Ige looking for the head kick.
Yep. Nice jab from Emmett. And a hook from Dan Ige. Oh, uppercut from Ige finds the target. Final seconds of the feature prelim. Emmett with a land. Great response from Dan Ige. In rounds two and three, Emmett very competitive in that third and final round as well. We'll see what the scorecards say. We're back in 30 seconds after this word from DraftKings. And final round, glad I'm not a judge. Now for the official decision, brought to you by DAV, Disabled American Veterans, keeping our promise to America's veterans. Here is Bruce Buffer.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judge scorecards for a decision. The judge score of the contest, 29-28. 29-28 and 30-27 for the winner by unanimous decision, Josh Emmett.
Well, the 30-27 is interesting, but Josh Emmett is your winner by unanimous decision. He has extended his winning streak to four. With that, thank you all for being with us for the UFC.
You can't touch this. Touch this.